And the Foreign Minister of Italy, Giulio Terzi, is joining us here in Washington. Thanks very much, Minister, for coming in.
Thank you. Thank you to you, Wolf. Good to see you again.
Syria, it looks like it's going from bad to worse right now. Is Italy ready to play a more assertive military role, together with NATO potentially, to get rid of President Bashar al-Assad?
The crisis in Syria, it is true, has reached an appalling level of catastrophic humanitarian consequences. More than 9,000 casualties, a huge number of refugees in Turkey, in Lebanon, in Jordan. Yesterday, Foreign Minister Davutoglu made a very impressive presentation to the G8 ministers gathered here in Washington, and he showed how much the pressure is from the inside of Syrian population to have refugees camp
outside.
So are
you ready to play a military role to help the rebels?
There is no question of having military forces, of using force against the Bashar Assad regime now. The use of force could be mandated only by the Security Council.
So until the Security Council acts, the international community, including NATO and Italy, no military action is going to be done.
No use of force until the Security Council decides so, and that is very unlikely that it does so, because this morning there was a new situation with, although a fragile ceasefire, but a ceasefire has been relatively respected by the Bashar Assad forces, and now the conditions are for the Security Council to deliberate. And in fact, these were the conclusions that we reached a couple of years ago, a couple of hours ago, at the G8 ministerial, that this is the matter for the Security Council observation mission.
Minister, would you be open to arming the rebels even without a United Nations Security Council resolution?
We will not do anything which apply the use of force without a framework of legitimacy which can be done only by the Security Council.
Would you support such a Security Council resolution?
If the situation would continue to deteriorate, but this is an unlikely scenario, because now
unlikely to deteriorate, is that what you're saying?
Yes, it is unlikely to further deteriorate for the time being, as we see
it
now.
You're that hopeful that it will get better?
For the moment, Kofi Annan made a report to the Security Council saying that there is a truce, which is, although fragile and not completely respected, that there is at this moment, this very moment, a truce which may give some confidence that the plan suggested by the Arab League is going to be viable. And we are relying very much upon the role of the special envoy of the Arab League, the United Nations, Kofi Annan. It has all our support, the Italian support and the G8 support. We believe that there is room for a political outcome of this situation.
That would allow President Bashar al-Assad to stay in power? Is that what your support?
No, there is no support at all in this case. We have said, and I said personally, my government has repeated time and again, that Bashar Assad has lost any legitimacy to continue to rule his people, and he has to go, but we must find a political situation.
So what kind of political solution is there? He's not going anywhere. He's staying there.
The political solution must include all the forces of the Syrian opposition. We have been part of the group of friends of the Syrian people, which has gathered in Istanbul the last time. We'll continue to support. We have already supported the Syrian National Council and the other component of the opposition. It is extremely important that the Syrian opposition is inclusiveness, respect human rights, and especially that it respect all the minorities, including the religious one. That is the future of Syria.
Because everybody who knows anything about Syria that I've spoken to, the Syrians and outside experts, they say some sort of accommodation that would allow President Bashar al-Assad to stay in power would not be accepted to the opposition. And the opposition wants him out of there one way or another. So I'm not exactly clear on why you think that things potentially, very fragile, could be moving in the right direction.
There have been many references over the last few weeks to the Yemen scenario, where although President Saleh was strongly in power, there was at the end of the day a conclusion which was negotiated. It gave a political outcome to the crisis. Something feasible, of course, Syria is a different reality, much bigger country, many more internal tensions in the social structure, an ethnic composition which is different. But there is a possibility. It's my strong conviction that is a possibility of a political outcome of the crisis must be guided by the Security Council, and we hope that the Security Council in the next few days will be able to mandate a mission of observers, perhaps in the first phase an advanced team or a core team, as they call it, with 30, 40 monitors, and then to be followed up by a larger mission, 200 or 300 perhaps, or even more, which could have free access to the country and to be able to control that the violence is extinguished, that there will not be accepted anymore any repression of that size that we saw by the Syrian armed forces, and also armed confrontation, not to give to Assad the excuse that there is a terrorist threat to counter. It is something that must be monitored by an international body, and in that direction there is a wide support by the European Union and also other partners in NATO and so on. That is the road to take, and we are very, very confident that this may be not likely in a very short term, but is the best option that we have on the table, the one of aiming at a political solution.
Well, that's the most optimistic assertion I've heard in a while, but let's move on to Iran right now. Do you believe Iran is trying to build a nuclear bomb?
There are many gray areas or very dark areas in the explanation that Iran has up to now given to the international community concerning its nuclear program. And the IAEA resolution, Board of Directors resolution, and 6 resolutions of Security Council have pinpointed exactly the areas where the explanation are due, and they have not been given. The monitors of the IAEA have not been gained a free access to facilities which are very important in military and strategic terms, like the Parchin, Fordo, and so on. So this is the point. Iran has a credibility problem. There is no confidence within the international community vis-à-vis the Iranian nuclear program.
So do you believe they are trying to build a nuclear bomb?
This is a widely accepted assumption that they are going towards an enrichment which can have only a military purpose, because when you have a large amount of fuel, which is above 20% of enrichment, and there is no possible commercial or research exploitation of all this fuel that they are producing, there must be something else. And therefore, they have to explain what is something else. Tomorrow, we are going to have the beginning of a new set of negotiations. We hope, quite frankly, Wolf, I hope that there is going to be the beginning of a continuous negotiation on the Iranian nuclear issue. This must not be one short meeting, one short deal. It must be tackled, the nuclear program. They must not be beating around the bush and talking about other things. That is the focus negotiation. Cathy Ashton is going to be there and to represent the European Union as well as the other members of the Security Council.
Have you severed, Italy, all commercial ties with Iran, its central bank? You no longer purchase Iranian oil, have you?
We are not purchasing Iranian oil, and we have been among the promoter of toughest sanctionary measures.
So no connections with the Central Bank of Iran?
No connection with the Central Bank. We have frozen the activity of Iranian banks already
a while.
A while ago, there is no financial transaction from Italy to Iran concerning the purchase of Iranian oil, and you have been among the most forthcoming among the small group of countries which have moved the European Union and the other in the world community. So it is our expectation that also the other major purchaser of Iranian oil could do the same, that there be no gaps in the effect of sanctions. The sanctions are biting. The Iranian economy is feeling that effect, and perhaps this show that they are coming back to the table. It is exactly the demonstration of the effectiveness of the two-track solution. They are coming back to the table while the pressure is piling up. But in terms of international security, I would like also to tell you that there was an important discussion at G8 concerning another aspect, which is very worrisome and increasing problem in terms of dimension and money which is concerned, which is maritime security, the question of piracy. There are more than 13 ships now in the hands of the pirates in the Indian Ocean, and more than 197 sailors, which are hostages, to the pirates. It is an appalling situation. It is something that the international community has to tackle urgently. And I'm quite pleased to see that in the G8 there was a wide consensus on the fact that there must be a more effective cooperation, more exchanging intelligence, more coordination among our naval units, but also a clear reference to a basic principle of international law, that is the national jurisdiction on military forces which are engaged in anti-piracy and anti-terrorist operation or peacekeeping operation. This is a basic issue because no country in the world is going to be cooperate or to be engaged in operation for international security, for the benefit of the international community, if there is not an assurance that the military servicemen who are risking their life are responding only to their national authority and not to some coastal state which may have second agenda in this case.
Well, that's a very important issue. I'm glad you raised it, and let's hope it works out. We're out of time, but a quick question on Italy's economy. A lot of Americans, as you know, are very worried. Greece, Spain, Italy. Is the economic situation in your country, Italy, looking any better or is it about to get worse?
It's looking much better than it was when the government, Prime Minister Monti, came to power. There's been a very impressive set of reforms. It's not up to me to say that, but there's been a common understanding in international observers, media, and the foreign governments. Every time I travel around the world, there is always a very positive reaction, even if I don't ask what you think about the economic policy of Italy. There is always a question, there's also a very positive assessment. Italy is going fast in the right direction. If you look today, I'm not particularly impressed by the stock market, which fluctuates every day. But the spread between the Italian bonds and the German Bund has decreased and has decreased by half since we were in government. And there are fluctuations over the last few days, but is decreasing again. So. This is an indicator, but when you look at the wide array of reforms which have been undertaken in Italy over the last 4 months, there is no comparison in recent Italian history. We undertook a social reform, pension plans reform, liberalization in many aspects of the Italian economy. Now a labor reform is in Parliament.
Are you seeking any U.S. Financial assistance?
We are seeking an increased partnership in terms of foreign investment. We have already made our country more attractive for foreign investment. And in that sense, we want to be involved in always more partnership and economic cooperation. But direct assistance, it is something that is not needed because now we rely very much about the effectiveness of the fiscal compact, which will become an economic compact at a certain point. Our policy now are switching towards growth and especially to the need. And I think that the reform of the labor market is going to be quite remarkable in that sense. It will create wider opportunities, especially for the younger generations. We are going to leave somehow the overemphasis that we have had up to now on temporary occupation, very short occupation, what we call the precari, to come to a flexible system of agreement which give also the entrepreneur the possibility of having a more relaxed approach to the question of taking on new people. So it is a complexity, it is a complex picture, but it's going quite in the right direction. It's not me who says that, but these are the foreign observers who say that.
We're counting on you. We all love Italy. We love visiting Italy. So we hope things obviously move in the right direction. Foreign Minister, thanks very much for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Appreciate it.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. Very pleasure.